Okay. And we have a concept called the tree width of a graph, which is the minimal induced width. The tree width of a graph is the minimal induced width. So, what do I mean by that? So, across all possible variable elimination orderings that you have, right? So, you can find out what is the induced width for every elimination ordering, right? And there will be some ordering that gives you the smallest induced width. Right, that is your tree width. It's the smallest induced width. So, the complexity of doing variable elimination is actually the order of where k is the number of values for each random variable. So, in this case we assume k is 2, so it will be order of 2 power tree width, right. So, what would be the tree width for a tree? One or two, depending on how you count tree width. Some people count tree width as the size of the clique minus 1, okay, in which case it will be 1, right. If you count as the tree width as the size of the clique, it will be 2, because I can eliminate it from the leaf to the root, right. At no point will I add a larger factor. So, every time I will be just collapsing one edge at a time, right. No point will I be adding a larger factor. So, if I eliminate it from the root to the leaf, then there might be problems, right, some arbitrary ordering, but the smallest thing is eliminate from the leaf all the way back to the root. So, every time we will be just removing one edge, right. So, if you think about it, the smallest elimination ordering for us here, right, also started off with kind of like the single node hanging off here, right. So, you have to eliminate C first. If you eliminate C at the end, then you ended up adding some other nodes along the way, right. So, getting rid of, you are somehow coming from the outside inward, right, or going from inside out was a bad idea, right. So, that's essentially what. So, for trees variable elimination is great, right, because it does things kind of in the best possible way you can expect it, right. But still there is a problem. What is the problem? I asked you to find P of j, right. If I had asked you to find P of h, right, you basically have to redo this computation all over again. Right. So, many of these tables that you computed internally could actually be reused, right. If I want you to find P of H, in fact, up till this point everything can be reused. In fact, some of this computation also could be reused, right, in appropriately modified form, right. So, but then you end up doing everything all over again, right, if I ask you to do P of H, right. So, there are more efficient techniques where you can keep caching these things away, right. The most popular of these is called most popular of this is called belief propagation, right, wherein you have some kind of a incremental way of computing these tau factors, right, that you have by passing what are known as messages between the nodes, right. And the nice thing about belief propagation is that it allows you to reuse a lot of the computation that you have already done for answering different marginal queries, okay. Any question so far? Right, so I can answer any marginal queries, you can see that, right. So I basically have to sum out all the other variables, right, and I have to find out an appropriate variable elimination ordering, right, and then do it. So the trick here is finding the right ordering. So I gave you the right ordering, right, but in an arbitrary graph finding the ordering is actually NP hard, right, finding the right ordering is NP hard. So it's you just have to do the best that you can. In trees it's easy, you can immediately see in trees, you can go from leaves to the root, but in arbitrary structured graphs, right, it's hard to find out what is the right ordering, okay. Great. So what about queries like what is the probability that I let's say get a job given that I am intelligent but I am not happy? Right, and also what is the probability that I don't get a job right. So this is essentially a conditional marginal, right. So I condition on some variables and I want to know the marginal, right. Okay. So we know that everybody here is intelligent, so once we figure this out, if j equal to 1 is lower than j equal to 0, what should you do? Huh? Be happy, somebody said that, yeah. So be happy, yeah, that's it. So that will actually put you in, we don't know, we have to evaluate the marginals for that, right. That doesn't guarantee your job, but but being happy at least well leaves you happy, right. I mean that's one of the things for getting a job, right, you want to be happy. So if you choose to be happy already, that becomes irrelevant. Anyway, so what do you do for this, right. So this is essentially, I can just compute this as right. So it is essentially ratio of two marginals, right. This is one marginal, right. This is another marginal. What is this a marginal over? It is a marginal over I equal to 1 h equal, the marginal probability of I equal to 1 h equal to 0, right. So this is the marginal probability of j equal to 1 I equal to 1 h equal to 0. So essentially I will have to eliminate all the other variables, I will be left with one table and from that table I can read this value. So if I eliminate all the other variables, I will be left with one table that has j, I and h as the entries in it, right, and I can just read off the entry corresponding to j equal to 1, I equal to 1, h equal to 0, right. And this one again is another marginal. So once I know how to compute marginals, I can also answer questions about conditionals, correct. Great. So last thing then we will stop, that will be end of end of graphical models for now, right. Suppose I am not interested in marginal distributions, right. So this is another inference query, I mentioned this in the last class, right. The second kind of inference queries we would be interested in are map queries, right. So why would we be interested in map queries? In fact, many of the classification and other things we have been talking about, we are only interested in map queries quite often, right. So, I will give you some image, right, I want you to label the image, right, I am interested only in the map estimate of the label, right. I want you to give me a label, I do not want the distribution over the labels, I want you to give me a single label. So, in which case I need the map estimate, right. So, which label is the most probable according to the posterior, right. So, that is essentially what I need. So, for finding the map estimates, so what do we do in this case? So, what I am going to do is once I decide this kind of an ordering, right, I am going to replace the sum here with the max. I am going to replace the sum with the max, right. So, I am going to say, look, this is max over C, right, of something, right. So, this probabilities I will compute. Then what you do is, you will, when I do this max all over and I finish the computation, right, I will get some probability, right. The probability is the map probability, the probability of the most probable point. Now, how do I recover the most probable point? This computation is only for a probability, right. So, when I say do a max over C, what does it mean? For every value of D, you will be entering one value, right. You have a tau 1 D, right. So, tau 1 D equal to 0 will be that probability, right, for which is maximum. So, look at, essentially you will have, when you finish this computation, right. So, you will have some factor, let us call it tau prime of C comma D, right. When you finish taking the product, you will have some tau prime of C comma D, right. So, tau 1 of D will essentially be something like this, tau 1 of D equal to 0 will be max of tau prime of, I do not know if I should go there, max of tau prime of 0 comma 0 comma 1 comma 0, right. This is what I mean by taking the max. So, my tau 1 D will be the max of, okay, when D equal to 0 and C equal to 0, D equal to 0, C equal to 1. So, of these two entries, whichever is the largest, I will put that as the tau 1 of D equal to 0. Likewise, for tau 1 of D equal to 1, I will take tau prime of 0 comma 1 and 1 comma 1, whichever is larger, I will put that there, okay. Now, I will go here, repeat, right. Now, I will be eliminating D here, right. So, for each value of tau 2 of gi, right, I will figure out which is maximum across d equal to 0, d equal to 1, right. I will put that in my tau 2 entry. So, likewise I keep going until I finally get a product, right. And now, how will I recover the actual point? Now, I have found out which is the most, what is the probability of the most probable configuration. How do I find out what is the most probable configuration? I keep track of which one gave me the max. Right. So, I keep track, okay, here for tau 1 D equal to 0, did I get the max from C equal to 0 or did I get the max from C equal to 1, right. When I had D equal to 1, did I get the max from C equal to 0 or did I get the max from C equal to 1. So, I keep track of, in every stage I keep track of which entry gave me the max, right. And then once I finish the computation, I just go back and read out the max entry. So, that essentially gives me the map, the probability of the most probable point and also the most probable point, right. So, if you have a tie, then you can choose one. So, it will give me at least one of the most probable points, okay. So, that is essentially how you do map estimates. And yeah, so it's rather bad because it is exponential in the largest factor, but it is useful for small graphical models because most of the other methods have a significant overhead in setting up the entire process. Right. Suppose you want to do belief propagation, you will have to set up the data structures corresponding to the messages, and it's a little bit of overhead is there in terms of computing. Right. If you have a very small graph like the earthquake graph, okay, you can earthquake graph, you can graph, you can do inference by inspection, right? Just look at the graph and do inference. You don't have to even do any computation, right? So some slightly larger graphs like this, right? So where you have to actually do some computation, you can do variable elimination, right, it is fine. But then you start talking about running it on images, right. So, I told you, right, we have like a lattice like structure, one node for each pixel in an image, and then I want to run this on a 256 cross 256 pixel image, right? Then you really need some help, right? And then such cases variable elimination is not the right thing to do, right? Because the first case the tree width can be large, right, for the, and so there are more efficient ways of doing it. And even belief propagation, right, in this kind of directed acyclic graphs, right, belief propagation is actually an exact algorithm, right. Even though it is pretty efficient, it is an exact algorithm, so can still be time consuming. So people look at answering queries in an approximate fashion. So I will not be able to tell you what the exact probability is, I will not be able to compute the exact, let us say, map probability, right, but I might be able to give you the map is the actual point that has the highest probability. But if you ask me what is the highest probability, I might not be able to give you that accurately. So those kinds of approximations we are willing to take so that we can do inference efficiently.